Can we turn these lights off, please? Can you turn that light off?
No, not.
Great. Thank you. Thank you. Okay. What about earthquakes in a place like New York? Is it fact or is it fiction? Come on now. You can do it. Can you turn that sound up just a little bit? That's good. This was the beginning to a documentary I did. I got another clip coming up, just to show you how time ages you. This was made in 1993, called The Earthquakes, The Terrible Truth. Can you turn that up just a little bit more, please?
This is a beautiful example of a reverse
Dr. Merguerian is an urban geologist, and this is his laboratory. He has identified numerous fault lines throughout New York City.
Earthquakes can occur here. Earthquakes have occurred in these things. Not large magnitude earthquakes, but there were not many people here, there were not many structures here.
New York City looked nothing like this in 1884, when a magnitude 5 earthquake shook it severely. Its fault lines, however, still exist, cutting diagonally across Manhattan through Central Park, 42nd Street, and under Greenwich Village. Dr. Klaus Jacob is a seismologist at Columbia University.
A devastating earthquake in New York City is inevitable. The question is only when, not whether. Is New York City prepared? No, currently not.
Many of New York's buildings are made of unreinforced brick and mortar, which will not withstand even moderate shaking. Steel-framed skyscrapers may not collapse, but their shattered plate glass windows could fall onto people below. Tunnels could snap, and bridges may be damaged. The scenario is bleak. No water, no power, chaos in the streets. A disaster for which this city is unprepared.
There's no consciousness towards earthquakes in New York City. There's no plans.
In the scale of human time, it's easy to forget that New York City is a moderately active seismic area with a magnitude 5 earthquake about every 100 years.
You ask people in New York about an earthquake, they will say, are you crazy?
I never had a real earthquake in New York City.
I probably have more chance of getting hit by a taxi cab on my rollerblades than of dying in an earthquake.
Well, I'm not in California. I know that's where they all are.
I'm not worried about earthquakes. Should I be?
The main problem here is the lack of awareness. People think an earthquake cannot occur here. It's not.
So, sure enough, I still stand by that. I still think that New York City is a place where an earthquake can occur. And what I'd like to do with you today is kind of show you the evidence behind it, where earthquakes have occurred, the mechanism for earthquakes, and the symbiosis between earthquakes and faults, which is well recognized. We do have a seismic record here in New York City, and the last major earthquake, in fact, was in 1884. That was a magnitude 5.2. We'll talk more about this a little bit later on. But you can see there is kind of a seismic signal coming through. And, you know, you might actually suggest that we're a bit overdue for a large event based on these numbers. Of course, the statisticians would tell us that the numbers are just not, we don't have enough data to make any kind of an announcement about that. Let me show you this. This is a view of what North America looked like if we set the Wayback Machine for about 500 million years ago. And 500 million years ago, North America was largely underwater. The equator was running something like that. In other words, North America was tilted about 90 degrees from its present orientation, and it was straddling the equator. Here in the New York City area, right down through there, we were experiencing what I like to refer to as Club Med conditions here in New York. I have colored, using a code here, the emergent land at the time. I mean, these are rocks that were actually emergent, that were actually supplying sediment southward. This was all underwater at the time. The yellow units represent units of sand and also lime that were deposited offshore from this continental landmass. And in olive green, we have a transition between this very shallow continental margin and what was formerly then deep water. So lime green with the volcanoes popping off all over the place, both on the west coast and the east coast, is a volcanic terrain. And that volcanic terrain was situated quite a distance offshore from paleo North America at this time. So this is about 500 million years ago, based on an analysis by many, many geologists over many, many years. So keep track of these colors. So the dark brown represents the oldest rocks in this region, and then these are overlain by the limey units and the sandy units in yellow, and then offshore in deeper water we have various shades of green. Turns out that the geology of New York City was produced originally in terms of its metamorphic parentage by a major collision that took place between that volcanic terrain that was situated off the east coast of North America and the evolving continental margin of North America that was actually diving into this volcanic terrain in a type of geological boundary known as a subduction zone. And in these subduction zones, lots of interesting things happen. There's lots of earthquake activity, in fact, involved with this type of motion. But more importantly, what happens in the deep regions of these convergent boundary settings is the process of mountain building and metamorphism. And sure enough, the rocks of New York City acquired their metamorphic character at depths probably close to about 40 kilometers or so, about 25 miles. And we know that by studying the minerals in these rocks. You know, minerals are like little pressure temperature gauges. They give us information on the former depths that these terrains were. So when you walk, for example, in Central Park today and walk on the metamorphic rocks exposed there, you're actually walking through a time and space portal that goes back a half a billion years in time and goes down about 25 miles in depth. So in other words, 25 miles of rock have been eroded in order to expose these rocks at the Earth's surface today. This geologic map was originally published with Charles Baskerville back in 1987 or so, and then I've modified it since based on new work that we've done in western Queens in the subsurface. This blue dot I'll show you again later, that's the epicenter of a small earthquake that took place in 2001 right on the 125th Street fault. This is a stratigraphic chart, and again, this was key to that original diagram, all of these colors. So the more ancient rocks, we call these the Fordham gneiss terrain. Y stands for Proterozoic Y and F for Fordham. On top of that are metamorphic rocks. The yellow represents the inward marble and the discontinuous quartzite down there known as the Lowry. Pamela and Patrick Brock over at Queens College have discovered some units that kind of sandwich in between these two. The Manhattan schist, in the strictest sense, was always thought to rest depositionally on top of the inward marble, but starting, I guess, in the earliest 80s with one of the first publications I did on this, 1981 I think was the year, I began to think about the possibility that the Manhattan schist is not a single unit at all, but rather represents a couple of slices of material that was formed in differing environments. And sure enough, starting from the bottom up, there is a little chunk of material there in orange that is depositionally above the inward marble because you can see interlayering. We call that the Wollumsack schist these days. The Manhattan schist, sensu stricto, is this kind of olive-colored green, and that's been overthrust along shear zones that formed during that convergent margin phase when subduction was taking place. And then the deeper water lime green material known as the Heartland Formation, that stands for Canberra Ordovician Heartland, that was thrust on top of that. And everything's all folded and bollocked up together and creating a very kind of complicated map pattern that has resulted from the deformation of these rocks that were originally sediments at tremendous depth in this former subduction environment. The geologic structure here then, if you take a knife and kind of slice across the northern tip of Manhattan, the geologic structure looks something like that, kind of complicated, showing a whole series of digitations, or folds as we call them in geology, and some major shear zones that separate the different metamorphic rocks in New York City. And just quickly, just so you can get a chance to see some of these things, keyed to the stratigraphic chart, the Fordham looks like this. It's a beautiful gneissic rock, quartz, feldspar-rich rock, lots of exposures, particularly in the Fordham area of the Bronx. The Inwood Marble is exposed in the Inwood portion of Manhattan and also in the subsurface in lots of different places. And here's a nice little structure, a fold within the Inwood Marble. And, of course, that stratigraphically is that yellow unit down there. This is the Wollumsack schist. It's actually an unusual composition schist. It's got lots of graphite in it. And this shows demonstrable interlayering with the Inwood Marble, indicating it was deposited on top. For example, that's Wollumsack schist, that's Inwood Marble, then you go back to Wollumsack schist again. So that, you know, the environments were changing a little bit, and that's been preserved in the metamorphic rocks. Now, the Manhattan schist, at least what I call the Manhattan schist, is a totally different rock from the Wollumsack. It's an extremely massive rock type. It's full of these little nodules of kyanite and sillimanite. And by the way, it's the kyanite that just screams out at us and says, hey, 40 kilometers deep, you know, those are high pressure, very high pressure minerals that could have only formed in those environments. So the Manhattan looks like that, and it's really a very durable rock type. In places, the Manhattan has been severely re-metamorphosed, and some of the large crystals of kyanite and sillimanite have been changed into books of muscovite, and that appears to be very, very late in the metamorphic history. Now, the Heartland, by contrast, is extremely rich in mica, the light mica muscovite, and by contrast, the Manhattan is more enriched in a dark mica known as biotite. So there's a compositional variation. And most metamorphic geologists would argue that these muscovite-rich metamorphic rocks of the Heartland represent former deep water shales, clay-rich sediments that were residing offshore in that volcanic archipelago. And as a testimonial to that, we find layers like this interlayered in the Heartland, layers of a rock that we call amphibolite. And these are exposures in Central Park, by the way, just south of the Metropolitan Museum of Art. Beautiful exposures there. These are interpreted to represent lava flows that have been interlayered with those sediments. Of course, that makes sense because we're arguing that these formed in an environment where there were volcanoes nearby. So the Heartland has all of the unique attributes. Well, here's a photograph taken when I first started doing field work in Manhattan. These were the days when I was more limber. And exposures were wonderful, right? Don't hold back on the laughing, gang. It's jokes like this that prevented me from making it to the big time, by the way. Here's Manhattan. Manhattan, a view from an airplane out of LaGuardia, and I've mapped the entire island of Manhattan. I've walked on every single street that you see in front of you there, looking for bedrock. Naturally, most of the bedrock is exposed in Central Park here. We're looking southward, naturally. But there's lots of other parks all throughout the city. There are outcrops tucked between buildings. My association with Cheryl Moss and Musa Rutledge has brought me a wealth of information from the subsurface in the form of borings from places all over the city. We've been working together on this for a number of years. And then I've mapped quite a bit of the tunneling underneath Manhattan as well. So I've seen it from the top down, and one of the questions that I always get is, well, you know, weren't you nervous about, you know, being out in Manhattan all the time, you know, mapping rocks, and weren't you afraid that somebody was going to bother you? And, you know, I said, well, no, I always wore the proper apparel, and I spent most of my career, or perhaps wasted it, mapping the subsurface geology in New York City. I was intrigued by the rocks of New York City as a child. And I pretty much just kept doing it. This is a view of the Queens Tunnel, which was bored over a three-year period in western Queens. It's one of the places that Nehru and I crossed paths. It's a 5 mile long tunnel, about 23 foot in diameter. This is a work train going through this bend in the tunnel. It's really kind of curious how they cut that. And this was cut by a machine, and this enormous machine, a tunnel boring machine, created this beautiful tunnel. Well, we got to re-examine the bedrock of New York City that way, and I luckily had the opportunity to map the subsurface geology in this tunnel. In fact, I spent about 150 days underground mapping, and mapped at the excruciating detail of 1 inch to 10 feet, 5 miles of 23-foot diameter tunnel. It took a while. This is what the canvas that I was presented with looked like. We're looking from the back end of the tunnel boring machine, and as that machine cuts through the solid bedrock, naturally it leaves a relatively clean trace of exposed rock. This is the conveyor belt to take rock debris from the machine out, and then these are supply lines for electricity and air and water, and then these are waste pipes. Naturally, these are the tracks that the locomotive used to bring people and equipment back and forth. This is the front end, the business end of the machine, about 87 feet from front to back. The whole machine's about 300 feet long, so it's almost four times the length of what you see here. This is a rotating cutter head with 19-inch carbide cutters. I'll just draw your attention to these guys sticking out on the side. They're called shoes. There's two on that side, two on the other side. And also, I'll just point your attention to some hydraulic cylinders. There's three on that side and three on the other side. There are enormous hydraulic cylinders behind these things, too. The way this machine cuts is really kind of fascinating. The machine is shoved up against the working rock face, and this head turns about 8 revolutions per minute, and the rock is chipped and broken off by intense pressure and propagation of cracks that then join together and then eventually excavate rock. When the machine's working the way it's supposed to, it's cutting about 9 foot of bedrock every hour. Unfortunately, the machine never worked the way it was supposed to, and that was because of the geology. It was totally different than what was anticipated. Here's another view of the machine, and here's the process. The machine pushes these shoes out towards the perimeter of the tunnel, locking up against the tunnel, and then these cylinders extend, pushing the front of the machine towards the working face under enormous pressure, something like 90,000 pounds for each cutter head up against the rock, and that eventually cuts through the rock. Well, I set up a field office in the Queens Tunnel, had an assistant, and we spent, as I said, about 150 days underground and then quite a bit of time above ground analyzing the information. I was lucky. I was one of the few people with an office down there, so, you know, a lot of people didn't have the office. I did. Okay, this is, what's this now? Oh, right, I'm going to talk about earthquakes to you today. And, right, I see, he always gets me. Here's a view of Manhattan, and one thing that's interesting about Manhattan when you look from the air is the obvious change in building heights when you look at the south part of Manhattan versus Midtown. And it turns out there are a number of faults that cut diagonally across Manhattan. Just for want of a better term, I'll just call these northwest trending faults, in that they have a geometry that's diagonal or northwesterly across the island. Turns out all of these northwest trending faults are underlying valleys. Cheryl Moss and I did a paper on this subject a year or so ago, the identification of a huge buried valley in the south part of Manhattan, and that corresponds very nicely with the building heights. And the reason for that, it should be obvious, you know, tall buildings rooted in bedrock, that works. Tall buildings swimming in soft sediment, that doesn't work. That really does, it is a first order control on building heights. You can almost map where these valleys are by tracing the building heights across the city. Here's a cross section from south there, and this part links up with that part, so it's from south to north, and again you can see these valleys cut into the bedrock, and each one of these valleys is underlain by a fault. Here shown in red, that's interpretive. But each one of these is underlain by a steep valley, and those valleys are filled with sediment. So it's these valleys that really kind of inhibit the buildings. In addition, There are a family of faults that this work was actually highlighted by the New York Times back in 1983 or so, the discovery of a whole series of faults in the East River Channel. These have a totally different trend, by the way. These are parallel to the avenues of Manhattan. That is, they have a northeasterly trend, actually north-northeast. So these are the two major fault families in New York City, northwest trending faults and northeast trending faults. And this is a diagram that I've colorized from Berkey, 1948, showing the Queens Midtown Tunnel. And notice that tunnel traverses through very different rock materials. There's the Fordham, the Inwood, the Fordham, back to Inwood again, and then back to Manhattan Schist or Heartland. And then there's the tunnel. So in the event of an earthquake along one of these faults, you can see the mechanical contrast between different rock formations. The blue areas are faulted areas where there's quite a bit of decayed rock. So these are fractured zones there. So if there's any earthquakes along these, there are going to be some harmonic shaking in these sediments, and perhaps these tunnels may not maintain themselves during that kind of event. Mapping in the Queens Tunnel showed the presence of a large variety of faults. I won't get into the tremendous detail on this, but this is just a statistical plot to show the orientation patterns of about over 300 faults that I mapped in the five-mile stretch of the Queens Tunnel. The important groups, these are arranged by age. The group A are older faults, and I'm not going to talk about them or the others. I just wanted to talk to you for a minute about the group D faults. These two red concentrations here indicate the orientation of perpendiculars or poles to planes. So the orientation of those faults are north-northeast. That's the set that's parallel to the East River. And then there's another set of faults, the group E faults, showing up in a concentration here and here, that represent the northwest trending faults. And these two groups, the group D faults and the group E faults, are the youngest faults. We verified this in the Queens Tunnel because the group E faults cut everything in the Queens Tunnel. This is a circumferential map, so in order to visualize this map, you really need to take this thing and fold it and curl it into a cylinder, because that's the level of detail that I was mapping in the Queens Tunnel. And sure enough, we found the presence of these unusual injections of volcanic rock, never described before, that seemed to cut some of the older faults. Yet, those volcanic rocks, which show up here in this view, these red-colored rocks, so these things came up as a liquid. Notice that they truncate older faults that cut the bedrock. You can see the offset there. But those faults don't travel through the red rock. Those are the older faults, the group B faults. There are other faults, however, the group D faults and group E faults, that do cut through the red rock. And we've dated those red rocks. They're about 300 million years old. So these faults are younger than 300 million years. And in fact, we think some of them are extremely young. And I'm going to skip over all that jargon there. Crown failure. This is the kind of, it's beautiful. It's beautiful stuff. And this is exactly the kind of failure you get where the rock is overstressed, right? Because faults occur where you produce stress in a rock mass, and eventually, I always tell the students, you know, you do this, right? You squeeze the rock, and eventually the rock says, and you can hear it, "I can't take it anymore." Right? And when that happens, then there's this episodic release of strain energy, and of course we call that an earthquake. Sometimes, in tunneling, if you remove the rock that's holding the rock mass together, you get this almost episodic burst of rock. In fact, I was almost killed by one day. I didn't need coffee that day, that's for sure. And these things just literally explode off the walls of the tunnel because of this pent-up stress. And they were particularly abundant in this particular part of the tunnel, station 253, because that's where the 125th Street fault cut into the edge of the tunnel. That's one of those northwest trending faults. Here's a map by McCoon on the left, just duplicated here on the right. So that's the actual raw information. The streets are overlain, but this is a map showing drainages going back to 1609. And what I've done here is I've plotted the orientation of faults, some of which are mapped in the field, and some of which are simply put there based on the orientation of creeks or topography. These two, though, I mean, this is the epicenter of the earthquake that took place in the January of 2001. That was about a magnitude 2.4 or so. And then there was another earthquake the exact same year, on the 27th of October, magnitude 2.6 along that fault, right at about 55th Street and 8th and 8th Avenue there, another northwest trending fault. And again, I've been kind of conservative. I mean, I could have put a lot more of these in, but these are real, and they certainly chop New York up into a series of fault blocks. When you put together the northeast trending fractures that cut through the island, you can see that there's lots of potential here for movement along fault surfaces. Here's a view of the fault up at the north end of that diagram. Here's the fault here. It has a offset that these are vertical layers within the rock, and the only way to get vertical layers offset, that layer, for example, offset to there, is to have horizontal offset. We call these strike slip faults. It busts up the bedrock into nice straight chunks. And in a way, at the outcrop scale, this is almost a microcosm of the last map that I showed you of Manhattan, showing these dislocations along these faults, because sure enough, field evidence indicates that offset along these faults are, in fact, left lateral and right lateral along these boundaries. So we were just looking at that fault right there. There's the tail end of the 125th Street fault coming across the northern tip of Central Park, and right about there was the epicenter of the January 2001 earthquake. The October earthquake was down there. These are just metamorphic rocks. The Manhattan and Heartland formations all tortured and twisted up in a whole series of metamorphic structures. That's not really important for our discussion here. Here's a view at the southern end of Central Park showing another one of these highly fractured fault zones through the Heartland Formation. The layering here is very steep, so the layers are sitting in there like that, and the faults are cutting right across it. If you look in detail at those fault surfaces, they show subhorizontal slicking lines indicating subhorizontal offset, again, identical to the others. There's the epicenter for the 2001 earthquake. It was situated a little bit to the south of the 125th Street fault, the epicenter, but that makes total sense because this is not a vertical fault. It actually has an inclination towards the southwest, so it basically then projects up to the Earth's surface along that fault surface. And this was a relatively small event, a magnitude 2.4. Along that earthquake fault. We had another one of magnitude 2.6 down here in the same year south of Central Park. Of course, these two events were on either end of the horrific events that took place here on September 11th of 2001, and the seismic moment of that event was very, very close to these earthquakes. The first collapse was a magnitude 2.1. The first impact, the first plane was a magnitude 0.9, the second plane was a 0.7, but the collapse of the first tower was 2.1 and the second tower was 2.3. So the energy released by the collapse of these towers was kind of analogous to the energy release of these small earthquakes. Yeah, he's amazing. Let me talk to you about the 125th Street fault. Having lived directly on the 125th Street fault for about 10 years, I feel appropriate to talk about. Those of you that are familiar with this part of Manhattan know that the number one train comes out of the ground at about 118th Street or so, travels along this elevated section, and then it goes back into the ground at about 135th or so, just before that stops at City College. I got my undergraduate and master's degree at City College and PhD at Columbia, so I'm pretty familiar with these trains. And it always amazed me that these trains seem to come out of the ground. Well, you know, it's not the trains coming out of the ground, it's the ground dropping off underneath the train. So there's a huge valley there. The 125th Street Manhattanville Valley is a place where we see this. And I had the wonderful opportunity to see this fault in the subsurface many, many years ago. in a very early phase of the New York City water tunnel system. And this is what the 125th Street fault looks like at about 600 feet deep or so. You go from totally coherent rocks of the Manhattan schist to an almost a knife-like change to intensely busted up and broken rock. And that zone lasts for about 200 feet or so of intensely fractured and broken rock along the 125th Street fault. I looked up into the crown of the tunnel, and I was amazed within that 200-foot zone to see Volkswagen-sized blocks of metamorphic rock rotated around vertical axes, again indicating this kind of motion, strike, slip, or subhorizontal offset along this fault zone. So this is, again, another one of these very, very important group E-type faults that cuts across the city. I think these are our seismic players here in the New York City area, and along with weaknesses generated by intersections with the northeast trending faults, these are the ones that we need to worry about a little bit. Here's just a close-up of that same highly fractured zone. So I examined this thing a couple of times in 1985. It's about 300 foot wide, sorry, it's a 200, highly fractured, about 2 to 3 meter wide zones of fault breccia, that means broken up rock. Large blocks show right lateral rotation in the crown of the tunnel, northwest orientation, and a very steep southwest dip. And then there are a number of slickened lines that are overprinted by one another, indicating repeated offset and repeated motion along these boundaries. So these are active faults. They're faults that could potentially show some offset. Here's a view of that valley from Fluor, 1969, showing this valley. Notice this valley goes down to about 200-foot depth, where it's filled with glacial sediment. The fault zone itself is highly pulverized, decayed rock and blue, and intensely fractured rock. I mean, that's the same image that we were looking at in the photograph a little while ago. Right? When you travel up the escalator of the number one train at 125th Street and Broadway and look out, you look down the axis of the 125th Street fault, and that bus is traveling parallel to 125th Street, traveling eastbound. And we're in a position now to look directly down. I was this close to getting arrested that day, by the way, for doing this terrorism, filming on the subway. They waited for me at the next stop. I couldn't believe it. I talked my way out of it, but it was close. Anyway, that's that 125th Street Valley. And here's a view up Amsterdam Avenue from the north end of Columbia University, again showing how that valley just drops down and then goes back up again. When you get up to 137th Street. So this is a very, very broad valley. That bridge that we were just looking at was built in the latest 1800s. Just draw your attention to these hinges that were put in. More on that in a minute. But this construction lasted a couple of years to build the number one train viaduct. And this is the 125th Street Valley looking east towards Long Island from a vantage point to the west. Here's the modern view. For those of you that long for the good old days, right? Here's a view, of course, showing the congestion now, and again, with the same vantage point looking eastward above that valley, and of course the ground slopes up in both directions. This is a strongly glaciated valley. We look northward towards City College, 137th Street, where the train tracks go back into the ground. And here's a view from the viaduct westward. There's the Palisades Ridge of New Jersey and the Hudson River, of course. And then same view a little bit more westward and northward to see the George Washington Bridge on the other side of the Hudson. So, you know, we're elevated here, but basically the train tracks are at the same level as the ground is north and south. So we're sitting right in the center of this very, very deep valley at 125th Street. Here's the IRT construction that took place at 117th Street and Broadway, and the next image is from right up here looking that away in modern times, again showing the train moving that way, and notice the traffic's actually moving downhill, right? There's another little clip to show that. Come on, you. There we go. So that, you know, there's where that last movie was taken, right there, shooting down that way, and the valley, of course, descends down to lower and lower elevations, and that, you know, there's the vehicular traffic that's moving down, and of course there's the little train there putting along on a more horizontal track, right? At the kind of lowest end of the valley here in Manhattan, the Manhattanville Fault traverses across that valley, and here we're looking at the footings of these of the archway here, and those footings were constructed to maintain integrity of this bridge in the event of an earthquake. Astonishingly, at the same time this bridge was being built, Merrill was doing his pioneering work on the geology of New York City, and he drew in the 125th Street Fault, and the building people said, oh my God, there's a fault though, we better put some hinges or something in there in the event of an earthquake, and that's exactly what they did. They created this this system where if an earthquake occurred, this thing could pivot this way. Unfortunately, they didn't recognize the fact that the earthquake, if it does come, the bridge is going to move this way, not this way, right? This is why it's always good to hire a geologist before you start planning any engineering construction. Sometimes they can give you a little bit of insight on what you might expect in terms of offset and in terms of motion. Okay. Let me talk to you about the Bronx River. The Bronx River in the northern part here is a very, very interesting case, because one of the big problems, in the very first movie I showed you, the fellow Klaus Jacob was talking about his role in seismicity, and the argument that we've always had going back and forth is the argument about whether there's ever been any groundbreaking in New York. In other words, he says, well, you geologists, you're all like, you know, you go down, you map faults, but you know, the offset on those faults took place when these terrains were down deep. They never affected the ground. You know, even though you have faults and there were probably earthquakes along those faults, you cannot demonstrate that those faults had any effect on what was happening on the Earth's surface. And to that, I argue that there is very interesting information here from the Bronx River, because the Bronx River travels south along this belt of yellow rock. That's the Inwood Marble, you might remember, the yellow rock. And in fact, that valley continues on that yellow rock and all the way down where it exits right here into the area of the East River, where the East River and the Harlem River join together. So the valley's still there. Unfortunately, the river's not there anymore. The river naturally occupies this valley because marble is an easily eroded unit in the Northeast because of the humidity and temperature. Yet, the Bronx River doesn't follow the valley. The valley apparently has been offset to the left, and the river instead cuts down this way through very hard crystalline rock through an area known as the Snuff Mill Gorge. Well, where this changeover took place, right here, John Sanders and I, many years ago, went to the WPA and found a whole series of borings along the track of that river to try and establish what was happening up there at that nick point. And we also conjured up this image of the bedrock contours. Now, these are the contours to bedrock at depth, right? This is not the topography of the Earth's surface, because there's lots of glacial sediment and stuff resting on the Earth's surface. These are the actual contours of the bedrock in the subsurface. And if you notice, these contours show that valley, the Webster Avenue lowland, does continue southward. And sure enough, that's where the Bronx River used to flow. There's also a huge bulge up here in the bedrock near East 204th Street, and that's immediately north of the Moshulu Parkway Fault, which is another one of the northwest trending faults, two others detected in there, that we think are seismically active. We argued at the time that strain building up along these two fault blocks actually created this bulge in the bedrock, and perhaps that bulge in the bedrock dammed the Bronx River up for a while so that it actually formed a huge lake behind that fault zone. This is not unusual, by the way. I mean, we get this in California all the time. The Palmdale Bulge, for example, is one place where the Earth's surface is bulging upward in response to strain along active fault segments. Well, in order to test that theory, we grabbed those borings, and this view shows the present course of the Bronx River and the former course over there, and we took a look at the borings, and this is what we found. We found that the borings showed a very interesting story. They showed quite a bit of fine sand and some gravel and lots of clay. Clay going to sand is kind of suggestive of a lake deposit back there, and those lake sediments are resting on glacial till. So in other words, this was very, very convincing evidence, at least to us, minority of two opinion, that the Bronx River was in fact dammed behind this this bulge in the bedrock, that that damming took place after a glacial episode, and that the glacial episode was then followed by development of that big lake, and then at some point that Bronx River cut through that bedrock dam and cut a brand new course into the bedrock. So stratified lake sediments overlie glacial drift, supporting the hypothesis that the damming of the Bronx River was in fact post-glacial. Now that's important because that means it's young. The last glacial episode here in the New York area was 13,000 years ago. Now that's this morning, geologically, of course. We looked at some of the bedrock in that area, and sure enough, there were lots of examples of fractured patterns in the bedrock with a northwest orientation. These are joints. They didn't show any offset, but we didn't see the fault itself, but we saw fractured rock with that correct orientation. And then we examined the new canyon of the Bronx River right down through there, and it's a beautiful, steep, V-shaped canyon that shows absolutely no evidence for glaciation. So in other words, this is a canyon that formed by very steep downcutting of that river, and all of the surfaces above are glaciated, but the valley itself is not. And that, of course, means that that valley was post-glacial, which supports the boring data that we found to the north. So we're pretty convinced that the diversion of the Bronx River is a testimonial to seismicity, and that perhaps a series of earthquakes actually caused that diversion and caused the shift of the former channel. So this is not stream piracy. In a way, this is stream valley piracy, because the valley was pirated to the left here. Okay, so just a couple more slides. I wanted to just kind of talk to you about what's the mechanism behind all this. I mean, you know, everybody knows about earthquakes out west because we're at a plate boundary. And sure enough, you know, the west coast of North America is tectonically active. We have a major series of alternating zones of subduction, as well as fracturing with San Andreas type strike slip faults. Up here, we change to another domain of subduction and another domain of fracturing through there and subduction through there. So this compression over the last 200 million years, in fact, has produced the Cordilleran mountain range. And the Cordilleran range extends almost halfway across the North American continent. It's a really broad zone of deformation. Those of you that are around the city tomorrow, in fact, I'll be speaking tomorrow at the New York Mineral Club show at 57th Street at 1 o'clock on Yellowstone Park, which is part of this story, because what's happened is the East Pacific Ridge, a volcanogenic zone within the Pacific Ocean plate, is actually physically spreading underneath Western North America, and that's causing some unusual thermal activity there. But the East Coast of North America is not near any plate boundary. The East Coast of North America, there's the mid-ocean ridge of the Atlantic that's pushing the plates that way, and of course that's the convergent boundary of the San Andreas and the subduction zones related to that. In a way, Eastern North America is kind of caught in the jaws of a vise, because this plate is being pushed that way, and the western margin of North America is being prevented from moving that way because of the San Andreas fault system. So North America and New York City, which is right in the center of this huge plate that actually starts here and ends there, Eastern North America is caught right in the middle of this rather large global vise. And as this mid-oceanic ridge of the Atlantic continues to spread, fractures associated with the spreading of a lithospheric plate on a curved world These fractures, and I said this 20 years ago, and everyone said, "Oh, you're crazy." Well, now the latest GSA meetings, people are starting to talk about this idea. I said, "Oh, that's nice," you know. These fractures, I think, it's these fractures that offset the ridge that actually propagate into the edge of the continental crust here, and I think it's these fractures that are making those northwest trending faults move. So we're looking at minor offsets and adjustments along these fracture zones that emanate out from the mid-ocean ridge. Okay, so can an earthquake happen here? You know, is this fact or fiction? Well, the facts are here. Earthquakes have occurred here. They occurred in 1737, a magnitude 5.2. The location of that is not very well known. Obviously, the seismic instrumentation was not up to snuff then. 1783 event, magnitude 4.9. The 1884 event is very well documented. You can look that one up in the New York Times database. 12-foot cracks opened up in the soils of Brooklyn, 10 feet deep, 2 feet wide. Liquefaction, the shaking of sediment to release it as a liquid, is reported as well. Now, again, if you just look at the periodicity here, clearly, although it's not enough data to make a statistical case, but clearly we seem to be overdue for a magnitude 5 or larger event. And I always wonder, given the time clock, the metronome that the Earth works under, I wonder whether those events in 2001, those two minor events, are perhaps harbingers of larger events to come. We certainly hope not, but we can't really ignore the facts, right? Because this map shows a distribution pattern of earthquakes, magnitude 5 of the larger circles, 4 or smaller, 3 or even smaller. But the large 5s, the 1884, the 1737, the 1783, I mean, those fit in very nicely in this overall image of active seismicity. So don't get the impression that we're immune to earthquakes here in the New York City area. We certainly are not. The question is, how well will New York City withstand a moderate earthquake? How is New York City built? Is it built like a brick? Well, or is there a frailty in our infrastructure here? Most people would argue that we are not built for earthquakes here. They have changed the building codes for seismicity, but New York City is not built with any thought towards earthquakes, because in the time that it was built, people didn't think that way. I did a documentary with Chuck Scarborough a number of years ago, and he went into the record and found that not only is the emergency preparedness building in an unreinforced concrete structure, but 60% of the buildings in New York City are in unreinforced concrete. And I actually offered my services for free to as a payback, because I felt as though I haven't gotten my education at the city university system. I could pay back, and I offered at the time the Giuliani administration some time to help educate the public. My idea was to at least let people know what to do in the event of an earthquake, and I found myself, pushed around a little bit. They didn't seem very interested, actually. And then one day I was in the office with the head of the emergency planning, and I said, "Joe," I said, "what's your plan in the event of an earthquake? I mean, the button you're going to push, what is it?" He told me, like this, he said, "It's the same button we'd push if a building fell down." Woefully unprepared, in other words. So, are we complacent about it? Or do we just ignore that it exists? I think we should do neither one. Turn that down a little bit. It's an appropriate song. A whole lot of shaking going on. I'd be happy to answer any questions. Questions? Yes, sir.
How did you get such precise readings on the earlier earthquake?
They're more precise than they actually are. They're estimates. Yeah. Yeah. They are, in fact, estimates. Thank you. There was no instrumentation in those days. No, it's based on felt reports. After an earthquake, seismologists go out into the field and, you know, with clipboards and official hats, record the types of damage. That's called the Mercalli intensity measurements. And from that, you can get an idea on the intensity of an earthquake. But there's no one-to-one relationship because damage is often related to the way things are built or the nature of the soil or this or that. So good question. Those are fictitious numbers based on felt reports. Yes?
How would you prepare for an earthquake?
How would I prepare for it? Well, I did. I moved to Long Island. That was the first thing. Living in the city, and I lived in the city for many years, the best advice I could give is to get outdoors. As quickly as possible, get outdoors. It's very, very simple. Naturally, standing in doorways are more secure structure in any building, but I worry about high-rise buildings in the event of large focus earthquakes. And believe me, I'm not a fear-monger here, and I certainly hope that we never experience an earthquake here in New York, but, you know, let's at least be aware, and I think, you know, there can be some real great modifications made in building codes to maintain building integrity during earthquake shaking.
So, Charles, when the shift hits the fan...
Yes?
What do you predict the...
Leave the jokes to me, would you please?
which way do you think the ground motion is going to be? Vertically, horizontally, or some combination?
I think horizontal, although, you know, commonly in when strain builds up, you do get you might get an offset, you know, one block moving up or the other. But, again, if this minority of one concept that oceanic fracture zones are propagating into the edge of the continental crust, those are going to basically be showing subhorizontal offset. And that's what the slicks say. I mean, almost every northwest trending fault I map in the Queens Tunnel, straight horizontal slicks.
Mm-hmm.
Sure. Why not?
We had one, what, was it 2003 in Westchester?
Did we?
3.6.
Oh, I must have missed that one. There was one in 1985.
No.
There was an Ardsley cluster.
It's the only one I've ever been.
Oh, really? Okay.
In Jackson Heights and Queens.
Oh, okay. Well, for some reason that one...
Okay. And
then
just one, I had a very strange pattern. At times, not something that said.
Right.
It seems to have been felt in southern Westchester, parts of the East Bronx, and selected neighborhoods in northwest Queens and nowhere else.
Okay. Yeah. It probably was not a big event. But, you know, New York has what's called high Q. It's the transmissivity of earthquake waves. And apparently earthquake waves, like electrons flowing through a wire, are transmitted very well throughout the Appalachians in kind of a northeast to southwest fashion. Earthquakes, for example, here are often felt in Montreal and vice versa, along that track. But I don't personally. I'm not a seismologist. I'm a structural geologist. Yeah. I don't really view this as science, but I find it interesting.
No significance to the upward motion as a result of glacial retreat.
There's no question that the Earth's crust is rebounding, and that's a good point. You know, is there the question is. Referring to the fact that the New York City area was covered by glacial ice, 13,000 years ago, and we think a number of times before that, but the last event was about 13,000 years ago. Now, when glacial ice pushes down on the continental crust, what that does is it forces the mantle to flow away, and the crust gets depressed. It's very sad. Yeah, sorry. And then when you remove the ice, what happens? The mantle flows back to reestablish its position, and the crust pushes upward again. So in fact, we're in a position right now where the crust is rising, which is really kind of interesting because they're telling us sea level's rising. So if the crust is rising and sea level's rising, sea level has to be rising at a more rapid rate than the crust is rising in order for us to see an effect here. What Professor Ohan's question is about, though, is does this vertical motion of the Earth's crust, can this prompt earthquake activity? And obviously, yes. I mapped a load of sub-horizontal fractures in the Queens Tunnel, too, that I couldn't really fit into any recognized model here, although they seem to be older than the 125th Street type faults. So, yeah, I mean, glacial rebound is certainly a factor.
If you have a set of conjugate shears and an upward motion, you can get strike slip movement.
Conjugate shears and upward motion. Conjugate shears, which way?
You had the point diagram, and it looked like there were a set of conjugate shears.
Okay. You can... You're talking about sub-horizontal shearing and vertical offset?
You said you had horizontal motions.
Right, so horizontal slicking lines, yeah.
The horizontal motions can't be produced by positive vertical motions if you have a set of these shears. And it looked like from the diagram yet.
Really? I can't visualize that. I can't visualize how vertical offset can produce horizontal. But I'll be happy to learn about it from you. Any other questions? All right, well, thanks for putting up with the hamster movies. Appreciate you coming, no kidding.